this coming in late, and you have all sorts of things that are not going to be able to do. That's going to buy you.
Part of this thing of middels in Duitsland, meer dan 65 medewerkers. Maar dat wordt in Duitsland ook gebeurd. Niet alleen zeg maar via het foundation niveau, maar gewoon direct aan de.
Okay, good morning. I'd start this next session on GLAM. Firstly, welcome Dominic, who's going to talk us about the GLAM Bootcamp, a new model for building skills.
Jake learned that skill at Playbook. have Glenn Bootkin, which was a program that we ran at the U.S. National Archives more than a year ago, in April of 2013. Just to give you the quick introduction, it was a three-day intensive Glenn Wiki training workshop for established Wikipedians, and it was organized by Wikimedia DC and the National Archives. Essentially, the purpose was that we wanted to enlarge the pool of Wikimedians working on GLAM projects by bringing into the fold Wikimedians who were already established within the community, but not yet part of the GLAM Wiki movement within the Wikimedia community. So we were really focusing on these people who already were Wikipedians. So just to kind of also say what it was not, that means that it wasn't about sharing best practices within the GLAM Wiki, movement, which is kind of what we've done a lot in the past in GLAM camps. It also wasn't about necessarily moving GLAM Wiki forward by improving the outreach portal or documentation or those sorts of things. We were focusing primarily on imparting skills to Wikipedians. And finally, it was also not a new editor training or tutorial, which means that we also weren't focusing on GLAM professionals. We weren't giving Wikipedia skills to librarians and archivists and museum professionals who hadn't edited before. We had a very small, very specific scope of what we wanted to accomplish. So just to kind of give you some background in how this all came about, I feel like the fundamental landscape of GLAM Wiki has changed in the last few years. So what I mean by that is we, the earlier days of GLAM Wiki, starting in 2009 through 2010, 2011, when, especially in the US, when we had the first kind of cohort of Wikipedians in residence, our really the main aim and focus of our projects was in doing outreach from the Wikipedia community to cultural institutions and trying to essentially get buy-in. We were trying to persuade cultural institutions to let us in the door. That really has changed today, especially in the US we've seen this. The change now is that cultural institutions have, in a way, come to understand the value of Wikipedia as a platform, and we need to figure out a way to satisfy kind of the demand within the cultural sector for Wikipedia programs. We have this kind of dual issue where we need to build capacity within Wikipedia for holding GLAM Wiki programs, and we also need to somehow build Wikipedia skills within the cultural sector. So we had this issue. The idea of GLAM Bootcamp came out of a session that we held at GLAM Camp in London here at the British Library in 2012. And the kind of question that everybody was asking was, how do we make more multi-tools? So what that means is, we have all these people in the movement, people like all the ones that were at GLAM Camp, people like me. We were thinking specifically of Martin Dahmers, who does so much work for GLAM outreach just on his own time, and that wasn't scalable. We needed more of these kind of program leaders within the Wikipedia community. So that was kind of this breakout session that we had. We wanted to solve this problem: how do we clone Martin? Really, the idea was about reducing that bottleneck. If we had more of the Wikipedia community engaged in GLAM Wiki projects, if we were more integrated in that way, then every time we wanted to do something, whether it's just a simple challenge or contest on Wikipedia, physical space with those local comedians who come to real world events, but there wasn't a lot of penetration into you know, the regular workings of the Wikipedia community. So we really wanted to focus on how we could not have just a new editor training, but kind of take those power users on Wikipedia and build their GlamWiki skills and make them into GlamWiki Wikipedians. And also a big part of that was how can we essentially give these people who are just you know, regular editors and not like a lot of the early GlamWiki power users, not coming from the perspective of you know, being in museums or libraries and being in the field. So a big part of it was just kind of you know, training Wikipedians in the kind of the principles and practices of cultural institutions. So we had that discussion at GlamCamp in London. Laurie and I went back to the US and we had agreed that we wanted to hold one of the first GlamWiki camps and move that idea forward. So we were well positioned for that because Wikimedia DC, you know, is one of the more active GLAM chapters. I went back and met with the board of Wikimedia DC, and they were enthusiastic. I was at the time Wikipedia in residence at the U.S. National Archives, and they agreed to be the host for this workshop. So we were able to have a conference room at the National Archives for 3 days, all day, 3 days. So that was kind of the genesis of this GLAM bootcamp. We early on tried to decide on what the best scope would be, what would we be training, essentially. One of the first things that we did when we came back was I kind of designed a sample program of all the types of sessions that we would hold. So the kinds of things that we thought were important for teaching an established Wikipedian about GlamWiki in order to you know, bring them into the fold were things like, what are the principles of GLAMs? The history of how GlamWiki, this movement, came to be, and also this concept of the life cycle of a project, of a GlamWiki partnership, you know, from the first approach to setting up your you know, the kind of the wiki project page to the first programs or what types of programs you can do, all of that. We also wanted to give some of the more practical skills to allow somebody to actually be able to put on a program or put on you know an event. So we you know, laid out model events that could be done, like edit-a-thons, and also, you know, tried to teach about how to do event planning for Wikipedia. You know, there's a certain kind of methodology that it's not apparent necessarily if you only ever edited Wikipedia online, having gone to a lot of events. But if you do Wikipedia events, you know about all these kinds of things, like you know, you create the meetup page in a certain way. You can do a geo notice that sends out the alert to people in a certain geographical area, how to send hundreds of top page messages to all the people in the area. All those sorts of tips and tricks. We also wanted to give some kind of hands-on tutorials for things like Wikisource and Wikimedia Commons, which some Wikipedians might not necessarily have been completely familiar with themselves, but which would, you know, be very relevant for GLAM projects especially. And then we had, you know, wanted to have discussions about things like conflict of interest, you know, how how you get funding, the copyright issue. So the way that these kind of played out was we broke up the kind of the type of sessions and had a combination of, you know, the more kind of lecture-like sessions where we were giving a presentation and telling people how things worked. And then we also tried to mix in group discussions about some of these things, like the conflict of interest and then the more kind of tutorial type sessions. And this all took place over the course of 3 days. So just to give you an idea, this is what the program looked like. We kind of definitely, especially with Lori's help, tried to think about the whole narrative of, you know, where we wanted to start with and where we wanted people to be by the end. And just to give you an idea of some of the sessions that we had, you know, I think one of the things that people really enjoyed was we started off with a talk from Mike Edson, who's the director of web and new media at the Smithsonian, and he gave kind of a talk to give people, you know, insight into how cultural institutions think, and also just to kind of, I think, galvanize them. And so that led into our discussion of cultural institutions, missions, all the different principles of LAMS, which is, you know, how it's important, because that's how Wikipedia can learn to speak to an institution in kind of using their own language rather than the language of Wikipedia, which can be very foreign. I think the other kind of really important thing that we decided early on was this was a small group. There were 12 participants, and it was actually not self-selected. It was, we spent a lot of time deciding who to invite to it. So the reason for that was, you know, the sort of workshop we were designing was something that you know, we were trying to find these people in the Wikipedia community who had skills and experience and standing within the community, but weren't already on the radar of the GlamWiki community. So if we just advertised through our normal channels, they wouldn't have signed up for it or known it was going on. So what it really involved was me kind of delving in and into the Wikipedia community and looking at who are the people that were active in, you know, notice boards on Wikipedia and Wiki project leaders, all those sorts of things. And some of them, you know, had never been to a meetup before. I was trying to choose people based solely on their sort of standing and experience within the online part of the projects, and not be prejudiced based on what they've even done in the real world. Because we were trying to essentially empower them to take that step and become people who, you know, be organizing things in the real world or reaching out to institutions. So we chose a group that was very diverse in terms of geography and interests and experience. There were no two people from the same city in the US and Canada. And many of them were either hadn't been to many events before, or maybe never been to a Wikipedia event before. I think a couple of them came from cities that had never had an event before. And so we were really wanted to be able to, you know, even if they didn't ever go on and start, you know, become Wikipedian residents, start the next great GlamWiki partnership, they might be able to go back to their city and at least use the skills they gained to, you know, have the first meetup ever, and that would be a success. So they were all very experienced in Wikipedia before they came. Another thing that was really important, just in terms of that goal of being able to choose choose the people that would be most relevant, is that from the start, we made a decision that all travel would be funded. So nobody was applying, for scholarships because they wanted to go to this, but they weren't sure. It was, we invited someone, and we said, if you can come, we're inviting you, and we're offering to pay your way. So that was the idea from the beginning. And we are actually lucky enough that five of the people from Land Boot Camp of the 12 are here today. I'm not sure if all five of them are in the room, but I think that for us, that really to me demonstrates just the fact that we made the right decisions in who we were choosing, and we were able to have some amount of success because none of the people that are here today are here because we wanted them to come to Wikimania. It's because they've remained engaged in the Wikipedia community and are now doing things like going to Wikimanias and have come here because they have their own kind of trajectory. This is just still in the middle of the presentation, but I actually wanted to, all of the ones that are willing, I wanted to have them just kind of stand up and say a sentence maybe about what they're doing now or have done since. So maybe just want to just say your name and what you're doing now, kind of thing. Sure. Yeah. Oh yeah, you can all come up.
Jake Orlowitz, user Okasi. I had no GLAM experience, and since GLAM Bootcamp, I started building the Wikipedia library. And at GLAM Bootcamp, I met Patrick, the interior, who is the co-organizer of the library. And I met Marilee at a related event, who is an outreach coordinator, and I met the project manager for the Wikipedia library, Alex Stinson, and I met the volunteer account coordinator for the Wikipedia library, who is Nikki Maria. So it was a pretty catalyzing event.
Hey, I'm Patrick. Jake already introduced me, but yeah, it was amazing just sort of getting some energy together from some very ambitious and really warm and cool people, and it was really well selected group. And so now myself, I'm working for the Wikimedia Foundation, actually, and also working for a library on the weekends and doing Wikipedia events through the library as well. So it was definitely a catalyst for sure.
My name is Jason. I edit as user of the Believer. I live in Portland, Oregon. And I was first introduced to GLAM at Wikimedia 2012. And I was really curious about how I could be more involved. I thought this was a perfect opportunity for me to kind of take away some skills and feel really empowered to do things in my local community. So I don't want to take a lot of time, but I jotted down a few things I've done. So that was in April, and in July I went to the Regional Arts and Culture Council, which is kind of the local arts consortium, and approached them and kind of did a pitch that we should have more collaboration in terms of public art and in terms of writing about artists and arts organizations at the local level. So they were really interested in that, and nothing's come to fruition specifically yet, but I'm still in talks with them about doing that. I've also had Wikilust Library events at the Portland Art Museum's Library and the Vancouver Community Library, art and feminism events at Portland State University and the Pacific Northwest College of Art. And I continue to tune into the GLAM Alps and really follow the GLAM Wikimedia community. So I love this opportunity. Thank you for it. And I hope that we can replicate it in the future.
Hey, I'm Nikki, user Nikki Maria. As Patrick and Jake mentioned, I'm working as the volunteer account coordinator for the Wikipedia library. And some of the other things I've done include an upload-a-thon for the BD Biodiversity Museum and edit-a-thons at University of British Columbia Librarians Group. And I also really enjoyed this opportunity to get together and talk about how we as Wikipedians can work with GLAMs to kind of develop those ties more.
programs and events grant from the Wikimedia Foundation, carried out by Wikimedia DC. So we funded the entire event with under $10,000 US dollars. Over 80% of that was actually just for the travel and accommodation, because we facilitated the event for free, the venue was free. I think all the other 20% was just the catering for lunches. We were also really lucky in that the chapter, Wikimedia DC, completely handled all of the logistical concerns of finances and booking travel and all of that, and catering. So we're all really grateful to James Hare, the president of Wikimedia DC, who took that on and freed Lori and I up to just worry about the program and making all of that happen. As you just heard, I think for the attendees, the biggest outcome was really about empowerment and making people feel confident to do these kinds of activities. These are just some quotes of what some of the attendees told us in our follow-up survey about the event. Things like they gained confidence to approach institutions, they liked meeting like-minded people, hearing from cultural professionals to get inspired, practicing thinking from a cultural professional's point of view, learning about what materials are available for reaching out to cultural professionals. One thing I forgot to mention before in terms of hearing from cultural professionals is we were also really lucky just in the fact that we were hosting this event at the U.S. National Archives that David Ferriero, who was the archivist of the United States, kind of walked in on the Saturday without really being invited just because he was excited. If you get a chance to look at the Glam Wiki Bootcamp category around comments, I don't think I'll have time today, but there's actually a video that that was taken of where you can see he just was having organic conversations with the attendees there and telling them actually some candid things about the profession and how it's changed a lot in terms of its attitudes towards things like social media in general and Wikipedia. There's also great outcomes for the Glam Wiki movement. And I think what we were really most excited about was that we got this group together that was not just the usual suspects of people who show up to events. And yet we still saw such great eagerness and a sense of empowerment from them. So it felt like we had made more of an impact than if we had just had a general event and allowed people from the community to come. And people came away intent on organizing things in the local community and contacting local institutions. And also just, again, as you've heard, just the idea of the connections that were made in that day. I think as we know, Wikimedia, making social connections is almost more important than the actual program itself. We have, I think, lots of success stories of what attendees went on to go and do or be, including multiple Wikipedians and residents among the attendees, recipients of individual engagement grants from the foundation for special projects. Emily Templewood, who is here at Wikimania, is the other one that she's now a chapter board member and has done things as well. And of course, numerous edit funds and collaborations. And I think just lots of reverberations of influence that we can't really even count. So that's all really exciting to me. And I wanted to just wrap up by discussing kind of the broader picture of how this plays into our conception of the future of Glam Wiki in the US. Because around the same time that we were forming this concept of Glam Bootcamp, we were also forming the concept of the Glam Wiki US Consortium, which is now a Wikimedia affiliate user group. And really the idea was confronted with this problem of building capacity. So that's the mission of the Glam Wiki US Consortium. How do we build capacity for Glam Wiki projects? And it's really, there's kind of these dual problems. We need to both do inreach to the Wikipedia community and give them Glam Wiki relevant skills so that they can go on and do these, become program leaders for Glam Wiki projects in the Wikipedia community, be those liaisons with institutions. And also, you know, we need to do outreach to the cultural sector, to the professionals and the institutions, and give them the Wikipedia skills. So for us, I think Glam Bootcamp was really just kind of the, you know, one tangible program for the former, for number one there, and doing training for the Wikipedia community. So I'm about out of time, but we can take questions. That's all I wanted to say. I will say, what's next for the U.S. is that we're going to be holding another Glam Boot Camp in the U.S. at the National Archives again in the next year. This time it's actually going to be funded by a grant from the Foundation for the National Archives, because they recognize that building up the profession is actually important for the National Archives, and it's not just coming from the Wikipedia, it's the Wikimedia side. But I also think one reason I wanted to bring this up is that, you know, the reason that we're talking about this here is that I'm really hopeful that one of the next steps is that this can become a model for a future workshop that can be held all over the world, wherever Glam-Wiki programs are being run. By all the chapters, so I would love to kind of spread this model.
This Glam Track going on for 3 days here, and we've been talking about this Glam Wiki toolset a lot. already. So I'm going to keep it relatively short, I guess, because I have an hour together with Dave, who's sitting right here, and he is going to go more into the how does it actually work. So I will give a little bit of context, and he will do the practical stuff. So first of all, the GlamWiki toolset is really a collaborative project. I'm working for Jurgiana, and I'm going to tell you a bit more about Jurgiana in a second. And we've been working on this with a number of local Wikimedia chapters, so Switzerland, France, Netherlands, and UK. There's another interesting story about that, because it's the first kind of like chapter collaboration with an outside organization like Jurgiana, which actually resulted into something useful. Which I think is quite nice, but I'm not going to talk about that. There's a link you can see here if you're interested. Liam did a really nice job of making a wiki with everything about the GlamWiki toolset, and you can also see how many images have been uploaded so far with the toolset. And for some reason, yesterday evening when I went to bed, it was 210,000, and this morning, 300 something. So something happened last night in the thistle, I guess. So a little bit of context, I work for Jurgiana, which is a European Commission funded project with the aim to make all of Europe's cultural heritage freely available to all without any restrictions. It was started about five, six years ago, and basically it was started with the idea, let's gather data from institutions from all over Europe, let's gather it, put it in one place, make it available to all. And the big idea is, or was, that you could have a portal where you would find information about all of Europe's heritage. We're now 5-6 years further, and maybe please not tweet about this, but I think a portal is not the most useful way of gathering all of the world's heritage anymore, even if it ever was. So Jurgiana, and I'm quite happy with that, is kind of shifting a strategy from let's gather everything we can and store it in a central place to let's facilitate the cultural heritage sector to actually make their move into the 21st century, to make their collection available to the public. And that, I don't think that necessarily needs to be in one central place. And we do a lot of advocacy on open data. So maybe quickly this. We store metadata, so descriptive data, and we make that available without any copyright restrictions since September 2012. Everything you find on the Jurgiana database is CC0. So no whatsoever, every data provider waives away all of its rights about this data. But we don't store content. We don't have a server like Wikimedia Commons. We don't store anything. And we asked, we have this thing called EDM rights, and that's where we asked the institution to make a statement about the copyright status of the object that we store the metadata about. And in the metadata, is then a link to the object that you can find on the website of the cultural institution. So we do a lot of advocacy work on open data, which I'm quite happy with. So we go to institutions and try to convince them opening up your collection is not only kind of your mission because you're a public institution, but it's also actually really useful for you because the more open your collection is, the more people can see it, the more people can do with it, and probably in ways that you would never think of. I think that in the last 2 days we've seen quite a lot of presentations that show that well. But then we had this thing that the institution said, well, we do want to open up, but how? And we would then refer to, like you can do it on your website, but you can use Wikimedia Commons, because that's where an active community is. You can use it in Wikipedia articles. And then we did convincing, and they said, sure, let's do it. And then, so like in the previous presentation, we needed more multi-tools, because there wasn't really an easy way to do a batch mass upload to Wikimedia Commons. It's, I don't know, who has ever uploaded something to Wikimedia Commons here? Oh well, yeah, that's quite a lot. well, I guess I'm in the right place for that. But, So, but it's not the easiest thing ever, especially when you want to do multiple objects and then you want to include your nice institutional metadata with that to make sure somebody can actually find your material. So, together with these chapters, we started developing the Glamwiki toolset. So it's not really a tool that directly benefits your piano, because we store metadata, and this is a tool that is allowing institutions allowing institutions to directly upload to the commons. So this, I quickly wanted to mention this, that where we currently are. So of all the European heritage, an estimate of like 5 to 10% is actually digitized. And this is the material that you want to digitize. There is already kind of made some checks of some stuff you don't want to digitize. You can put time in the duplicate or you can just throw it away. 10% of that is in Europeana, and about 30% of that is actually open. So if you do the math, a really small percentage is actually purely openly available. It's still a lot, but there's still a lot of work to be done. So, the Glamwiki toolset. The aim of it is to help institutions to actually easily make their digital content accessible to Wikipedia users and all over the world, and to allow the GLAMs to automatically upload large batches of digital versions of their content to Wikipedia Commons. So that's plain and simple what the tool does. It's a tool. So this is, if you just look at the tool, this is what it does. GLAM Commons. But then the next step is, because when you upload something to the commons, that's hopefully not the end point. You want to see it being used and useful. So that's where community comes in. So that's what we, Liam is going to do quite a good job at that in the future. We want to work with the European network partners. We work with about 2,300 institutions. We want to work with the willing to upload their material to the commons and then connect them with the Wikimedia community. And I think that I'm quite happy to be working for a place like Georgiana, because I think we're in a really good position, because we have the network, we have worked for 5-6 years to connect with all these cultural institutions, and now we can make the connection to the wider Wikimedia community and Wikipedia. Thanks to Sebastian, by the way, for making these nice visuals. I can call them shamelessly. This is your attribution. and I will put it in the end. So this is what we're working on. Connect the institutions with the Wikipedia community. The toolset is just a tool to enable this, to make it easier for them, but it's definitely not the end. And now you're probably all curious how the tool actually works, but that's Faye is going to talk about. So I'm quickly going to tell you about the next steps. We need to make it easier to use, because you still need to be some kind of a metadata expert, which probably most institutions there is one, but it could still be easier to use. We want to have metrics, so what happens with your upload once it has been uploaded? What happens to your content? Where does it appear? There are some nice glamorous tools, but I think it could definitely be better, so we will be able to work on that in the future, and involve more chapters. So we have four that I mentioned earlier. They're comfortable and interested, but this is a tool you need to be, you need to get some kind of permission to use it, but we're quite, because it's quite a powerful tool, I guess, if you give it to anyone, you could easily flood the comments. But involve more chapters and connect these chapters to local GLAM institutions and work that. So get in touch. Again, this is the link with some accurate metrics where the image is being used. And there's a nice category where you can easily see all the images that so far have been uploaded with this particular toolset. So thank you. I guess it's good that Faye gives his talk now first, and if then there are questions, we can go take it. Thank you.
Everybody feeling mellow this morning?
Yeah. There was a lot of socialising going on last night. So, this isn't going to be a New York style rattling through the slides. It'll be more of a mellow European presentation.
Maybe a slightly louder mellow
European. Is this more mellow?
Louder mellow.
Even louder. Down. Right. I just thought, just a very simple guide. We had a discussion during the hackathon. We had a workshop and ran for an hour and 45 minutes talking about the GlamWiki toolset and some of the issues and challenges, the ins and outs. And there were quite a lot of technical questions. So there isn't time for a lot of technical questions, but this will give you, should give you an insight in how to go about the basics and what this thing is. I mean, there's not a lot of chat about it. I'm just a volunteer. I'm not associated with anybody. But I was on the steering group for the creation of this tool, which we started about 2 years ago, I think it was. I've also been involved with the Chapters movement. I was the UK Chapters chair and chair of the Chapters Association. But my interest for the last few years has been in commons, and so I know how commons works quite well. And I'm probably at the moment the most active uploader to commons for various reasons. Let's see if we can get this. I apologise for Google.
Hey, can you close the lights above you so we can?
Do you need lights?
Yeah.
Oh, look at that. Even better, maybe, could be this. Too bad. I didn't want to spoil the romantic vibe. As has just been said, there was quite a background to this. We were pushing the foundation 2 years ago to have a program for better tools. There was a lot of dialogue about better GLAM reporting. And we all knew that uploading was actually a pretty tricky thing for large collections. You could upload 100 images, 1,000 images, but if you were talking about 100,000, suddenly that was an awful lot of effort and probably involved programmers doing special things. And that could be a lot of fun for a hacker to do that for you, but we can't necessarily find lots of hackers to do all these uploads for every GLAM that might be interested in making their collections public. So GLAMs wanted a solution, the volunteers wanted a better solution, so the commons could be more reliable and a robust solution for launching things into the public. And we chose Europeana, the steering group chose Europeana to do the development. And they executed that very beautifully and put a nice team together. And it's not been inexpensive. It's been 200,000 euros, but that compares quite favourably to the costs of doing it through the foundation, actually. And we've ended up with a tool that can be maintained and is reasonably well documented, and we're working on improving that. So people know that it does uploads. To avoid any confusion, I'll just explain that it's a direct upload service. Commons doesn't normally allow uploads from other websites directly. There are a couple of minor exceptions where people have built special tools to do it, such as Flickr to Commons is a tool that does that. But normally most users have to upload from their hard disk, and then as they do it, they have to write the documentation for it and so forth. And at the moment, the tool, there's a collection, a catalogue, like the Library of Congress, available online, and you can whiz through thousands of images from that site. And if there's a library catalogue that has the images in it, you can do the same thing from anywhere. The other side of it that people found rather tricky was we had a long dialogue, and I dare say there will be other dialogues that we had about it, about how to map metadata and libraries, galleries, archives are very interested in metadata and the issues and challenges. The metadata is lying around, and we didn't agree a standard that Commons would use or that would be forced on institutions. We wanted a flexible solution that you could map from one to the other in an easy way. And I'll show you in practice how that works. I said there's no particular reliance on programming skills. That was, we wanted a user-friendly solution. However, it kind of helps to have someone around that you can talk to with a bit of programming talent. We still need an XML file to come into the tool. And as we mentioned, you probably need to have a data expert who can sort of explain how your metadata works and possibly how it might be inconsistent. I find that when we're talking about more than 100,000 images, you find sub-libraries within your collections that don't quite match what ought to be the standard for various reasons. And you need to think about how to manage that. Somebody came up to me yesterday talking about large images, which was a very interesting discussion, photographs of church ceilings in another country. People don't quite understand that you can actually upload files of up to 1 gigabyte. The normal upload wizard will only allow you a file much smaller than that. And for most collections, 1 gigabyte sounds pretty large. Exceptions might be, say, video uploads, which are more complicated. But for images, the uploads I've done, 300 megabytes is actually an extraordinarily large image, and I've done uploads of that size. I've uploaded books, which are more greater than that, up to 0.5 gigabyte. Bigger than that starts to look slightly extraordinary. You might wonder why the file isn't quite so large. And Commons accepts a very wide range of file types. We're normally talking about images with the GAMWiki toolset. We're normally talking about JPEGs, aren't we? There might be TIFFs. We've got these raw TIFF files. But Commons actually does allow things like vector graphics files, which I've uploaded some from Cancer Research UK. Audio files, I've uploaded collections of audio files, and we've had video files that I've uploaded through the GAMWiki toolset just recently. So what the tool does, very simple in concept, it takes a list of images that you give it, you tell it where to source those from, so here are the links to where the image can be found on the internet, and it sucks them all in for you. It's quite a simple concept. For the Foundation and for Commons, they limited this service, it's called Direct Upload from URL, or URL to URL, or something they call it. They limit it because they're slightly worried about security concerns. I'm not sure I entirely understand it, but there are legitimate concerns about keeping the project stable, things that you allow to be sucked in from other projects. The other thing that is conceptually slightly confusing, although you run the web front end to tell the tool what to do and what to upload, that doesn't actually use your computer to do it. So for my uploads of some quite large collections, I just use my 7-year-old Mac Mini that's a bit underpowered, and that's fine. You don't need any special kit or tools or special software, just a web browser. And then the actual upload runs using the Foundation servers. Somebody's waving at the back.
Is it limited only to images?
No, it will take anything. We've got examples of videos. I don't think we've done audio files, but any standard that Wikimedia Commons accepts, the tool will upload. So it's quite flexible. And of course this upload service, if you're uploading the last few weeks before Wikimania, it took me 7 weeks to upload 290,000 images. That was something like 7,000 images a day. That wasn't using my kit. I could switch my computer off and go to bed, and magically this stuff was appearing on Commons because it was happening through a batch service on Foundation servers. Very nice. So, that's all the tool. Let's have a look at what it looks like. First of all, it's what's called a special page. The different Wikimedia projects have a collection of special pages that do interesting things. And one of them has been added to that GLAMWiki toolset page. But that's how you can find them. Just go to Wikimedia Commons, and in the tools at the side, there's a list of special pages, and one in that list is the GlamWiki toolset. Or you can use this link, GW toolset, with special in front of it. And that takes you to this page, which handily has a little navigation bar in green. You at the back won't be able to see anything on this, I would imagine, but there's you can take my word for it, there's a navigation bar in green at the top right, which gives you several interesting links. The top link is very useful. It's been worked on by our project team. A summary of who to contact and what the tool is about, and materials like the user manual. And we're hoping to work on some training materials that can be reused by people. And interestingly, a set of existing users and their projects that you can use as a reference. So if someone's done something very similar to what you're thinking of doing, it's a good idea to go and look at what they've done and how they've done it. And you might actually want to write to them and say, ooh, can you tell me what issues you've had? And they might tell you about it. The other thing there is a user manual. Go and read it. It's a very good idea to have a look at the manual. And what you'll find on the manual page includes some nice demonstration videos where the tool is walked through by Dan, who developed a lot of the tool. And he just walks you through how the mapping works. It's very nice to see someone actually doing it. It takes sort of the fear out. There's a little arrow on there as well as read the manual. There's also get whitelisted, and this was just mentioned. You have to, if you're uploading from a website, the way the domain isn't currently on the list that's on the list of approved websites in the tool, there's a link there to click on and raise a request to get your website whitelisted. Sites like the Library of Congress and Flickr are on there, and the Rijks Museum, for example. And again, it's just a question that we don't really want to whitelist sources that are overly flexible. An example is Google Drive. There is a domain for Google Drive, which means absolutely anything anybody dumps on there. So we don't really want to start uploading, just approve Google Drive as a URL to your upload service. That's a bit too wide. So that's the reason why we have to whitelist our sites. So you can't sort of go to the tool and start using it instantly.
Could individuals ask for a cloud directory of their own to be whitelisted?
No, not at the moment. And that's something that we are looking at. I'll come back to that as to the issues you mentioned previously.
Why not at least to have a demo page for this? Because, for example, I was just thinking whether to use it or not, but there is no way to just take a look how does it work. And the manual is very, very long. So
yes, it is. It does look very long. That's why I suggest you use the video on the manual page. Actually seeing it working is very helpful. You can, as I'll mention in a moment, you can use what's known as the beta cluster. There, if you search for that or ask for perhaps for a link to find it, you can actually go and use the GlamWiki toolset without any approval to use it and play around and make a mess on the beta cluster, and nobody will care. So that's a good way of testing and training yourself. But then, if you were testing, you'd use somebody else's online collection, and you can just run it from the Rijks Museum or something, play around with the collection.
It's not directly linked on this site, right?
No.
Was just trying to use this a month ago, and I just give it up just because I couldn't fast find the kind of demo if I really need it or not, and then applying access with
knowledge of what you're about. That's fine. I'd apply for access anyway if you've got a project in mind and experiment with it.
No, I expect so, but
I'll come back to some of these issues. If you wait a moment, so some of this might be covered in the slides you're about to see. On that same page, I said you go to the special page. This is actually the page that does the work. It's just a page on Commons. You set it up with a couple of, the manual explains some of this in more detail, but you select you tell it how your input file is structured, that's what that first thing is. You tell it what template applies to that collection. If you've got a mapping already, you can point to that, or you can do it on the next page. And there is actually a link to something I would recommend you use, which is an XML validator, which means that you can cut and paste your XML file into that, and it tells if you've got some weird bug in it that might cause you a problem. And then you point to your input file, which is basically the list of files you want to upload, along with a bit of metadata about each one of them. And it will draw upon that and run the upload. There's no limit on the size of that. At least there is a size limit on the XML file, but I've uploaded lists of, I think, something like 24,000 files in one XML file. It hasn't been an issue. Larger than that is probably slightly silly to manage, I think. And then when you press OK to that, it takes you to the next page, which is about doing your mapping. We said there's this easy visual metadata mapping. If you go to the manual page, that video demonstration, which I won't run for a laptop like this on a screen where you can't see the detail, is quite handy. It just shows you actively how you go from one to the other. It shows you the metadata, your input record on the right-hand side is nicely displayed, and then you've got drop lists mapping to the parameters of the template on Commons. And this actually is quite tricky conceptually. If you work inside an institution and you're not familiar with things, and you don't quite understand what these templates are about, this doesn't give you a nice visual front end of doing it without worrying about it too much. And so you go through, you populate those things. Once you've done your population, you can actually save the mapping if you want to, so you can reuse it for another upload some other time. And there's a clever little wrinkle I point to there, is that actually these are parameters of the photograph template on Commons, and you can join several of your input fields together. So if actually you want to, you've got several complex fields in your metadata, you can put them together on, say, the description field or the notes field, or you could stick several dates under the date field, one after the other. And then, once you've done the mapping, you've got your basic category set up, you press go, and it takes you to a preview page, which shows you some example files. It shows you the top three files in your collection, and shows you exactly how the image pages will work. You can go back at this point and say, oops, I forgot to add something, or that category is, or the template isn't behaving how I expected. But it gives you that quick check to go back again. So that's actually a little something that we added recently. So that's all the tool is, really. It's just those selection of web pages. You do a bit of mapping, you sort out your input file. Now, conceptually, when we had the workshop in the hackathon about this, conceptually, I like to think about it very simply. There's, before you actually use those pages and run an upload, there's actually doing the upload, which people are very worried about it, actually working, and what happens if it falls over, things don't quite behave the way you expect it. And then there's the afterwards, because you don't just dump 100,000 files on Commons and then run away. You have to be prepared to continue having dialogue with the community and deal with issues as they come up. One of the biggest issues that I'll emphasize is what you have to prepare for before you do that upload, you know, using this quite powerful tool, is having a discussion about how you're going to use categories on Commons. There may actually not be very good categories on Commons for your subject area. We've been discussing medicine, for example, and medical categories are slightly inconsistent. I've done uploads on animals, such as birds, and actually the taxonomy on Commons is rather good in terms of using scientific names, not so good on using common names, for example. But you'd want to actually have a dialogue with Commons regulars in that area about whether to improve categories might be a good idea. And you can, there are ways of working out what categories exist and deciding how to map to whatever keywords you have. For example, one of my recent uploads was from the Rights Museum, and their tags were all in Dutch. It wasn't that obvious sometimes to work out what best Commons category match. So that was a bit of manual work up front. And for about 2,000 files, we had about 30 mappings that we had to work out before we actually put that to the tool. And it was nice to do that up front, rather than uploading a huge amount of stuff and then trying to sort it afterwards with people in the community saying, what is all this stuff and why isn't it categorized properly? So the question for an uploader, someone planning this upload, is what is your plan for community engagement? Do you understand where to talk to the community? And how are you going to promote this within the community to use this stuff? And there are, within the Wikimedia projects, there are these things called Wiki projects with specific topics of interest. So for American heritage, there is a Wiki project, American history, and they're very interested in the National Register of Historic Places, and they know exactly how it works, and they have a preferred way of doing it. So that's quite a good idea to go and talk about what templates to use before the project started. And as was mentioned, you need a special right for the GLAN Wiki tools. That has to be brought up in the audience, do I request this right or not? It's considered quite a powerful thing to do, to remotely let 100,000 images be uploaded for you. It's quite a big thing to sort out and fix if it went wrong. You need to whitelist your source website. And I suggest you run tests. And even if you don't use this thing called the beta cluster, you want really to suck it and see with 100 images before you upload 7,000, just to make sure everything's really working well. There's no reason why you can't do that. You should break your upload. People get a little bit confused, I think. It's a bit of a technical challenge. What this XML file is. XML files are just text files, they're just structured rather nicely. And you may not be able to see any detail on this very detailed slide, but it's just a set of records, and inside each record are things like the name of an author and the date of the work and a description of it. And you just tag those, you know, with author and end author tags in XML. And if you want to see some examples and a very detailed description, there is a Wikipedia article about it that's very detailed. It'll give you history of it, also show you some interesting examples. And we do have some examples in the manual. And as we produce the training pack, I think we'll probably take a lot of these real examples and explain how we went about it and how they were created. They're not all created by hand. A lot of these might be exported from your catalogue in CSV format, which is another text format, and then you wrap those in a way that makes them look like an XML file. We've been talking about how to improve this bit of the process to make it a bit more user-friendly. This is an improvement we're looking at, and it would be nice to offer a better service than we do. And that may or may not include offering actually a hosting service. I'm not Foundation Ops, but I'm working closely with them on having a better solution to this. But that is an improvement we're looking at. It's, you know, for the time being, it's for stuff on the internet that you can draw upon. You could drop this stuff onto a Flickr account and upload from there, but that seems a bit round the houses, so we'd rather not. But for very large donations, like 300 gigs I've got to upload, there is a process of uploading from the hard disk, but we'd like to actually build that into the GLAN Wiki rather than going special. I'll take Andy's, then I'll move to the next slide.
This might be digital kerosene, but is there a point at which it becomes more effective to put a hard drive into the post or air freight it to a service farm somewhere, rather than spending days and days uploading stuff?
Yes. And that's exactly what I've done with Welcome Images. I'm hosting a USB disk to a foundation ops person, and they're doing it online. But it's a really weird, hacky sort of way of doing it. And it would be nice to offer a service where you could upload 300 gigs of images, and it wasn't a weird, hacky, one-off way of doing it.
So but what's the cut-off point for
that? I wouldn't put a cut-off. I'll come back to this. We're sort of digging into a lacuna. So we've sort of maybe looked at it before, we're on the go. You do that visual mapping, there's no particular time limit on that, so you've got plenty of time to get it right. You have a preview. We don't have a very good process of checking your uploads as they go on. So with my very large upload of 290,000 images, I did that in batches of up to 14,000, I think it was. So if something went wrong, I could sort of go back and diagnose it rather than coming back to it next week once they're all finished. We're improving on that. I'll mention that other improvements. And if something unexpected goes on and you need a bit of help, there is a rather nice user list, which I've got the link to down there. It's on the Wikimedia standard stuff. It's also linked to on that. But when you go to that main page of the tool, it's there under the links of more help you can get. It's quite easy to find, and it's in the manual.
Ben, before you go on, can you explain better? I think not all of the people here know what you mean by mapping. So
right.
If you can say something.
For the use of this tool, the mapping is taking information from your catalogue, like author and dates, description, and that mapping is just pointing to where on the standard Wikimedia Commons template you want that to end up and be displayed on Commons. Normally, there are very similar fields. So.
Can you show the slide that you've got? That's
yeah.
Actually,
let's go back to. It's a bit hard to read on that slide, but that is the mapping. Someone's brilliant next door trying to get out.
Mapping always have that sound.
Yeah. It's not my fault. I've not been something weird. Is that our speakers?
I
don't know. It could be. Look at the tape. Oh no. So I'll put it out.
No, it's just in the.
I'll carry on while you investigate it. No, that's fine. Fix itself. Okay. So if you look, there's the metadata I'm putting in. This is an example from the Rijksmuseum on the right hand side. And this is sucked straight out of their standard catalogue, it's actually pulled out of their API. Scrape from their website, it's the same data. And within there is things like the description in Dutch, a portrait of Elizabeth I in the 17th century. And that's that description is then mapped to a field called description in the paintings template. But it could be called whatever it is relevant to the paintings. So that's what I mean by mapping. It's just this bit where you do the visual mapping. The mapping, well, on the front side to the other. And previously, this was the sort of thing that you had to put in a Python array or something and then suck it through a Commons API or something as well. And this does all of that for you. And it's just a visual web page. Okay. So I'll finish these. So after uploads, so it's best not to leave it alone. Things will come up, there'll be things to learn from. Maybe after your first set of uploads, you've chosen to do 100 images or 1,000, you'll start getting some feedback and you can ask for feedback. And there needs to be an easy to find point of contact. For large institutions, this is a very large uploads, this might be a slight issue. So for example, with the Wellcome Trust, understanding what's happening in the background with copyright validation is a slight issue because they've got confidential records of the background of where the donations come from. And so that's an example where it's very nice to have a point of contact that can be approached and might get back to the community within a few days or a week, and it doesn't just disappear for months before we get an answer. On Commons, if we're unsure, we'll probably end up deleting some of the files because we remain unsure for a month rather than worrying about it too much. You also need to promote the collection. If you've uploaded a lot of images, you might find the usage percentages a bit low. You know, maybe after a month you've got 1% usage. Actually, that's really good for 100,000 images. It's nice to monitor that. But also, if you want those numbers to go up and to demonstrate the value of your collection, you need to let people know it's there. And that's probably not just putting a blog post on your own corporate blog, but actually engaging with the community on wiki projects and notices on some of the projects where they're most likely to use it. So, for example, with the Rijks Museum, as well as putting a notice on Commons, it might make sense to put notices on the English Wikipedia, the Dutch Wikipedia, and the German Wikipedia. Feel very relevant. And then there's a longer issue, which we haven't bumped into yet, because we've only been running this for such a short time, is what happens with these large uploads in the long term. You know, we've uploaded 200,000 images. What's happening next year, when maybe there's another 100,000 to upload, who's going to do it? Or from that 200,000, maybe we've learned something and we've changed our catalogue. How do we work out the deltas and do something about that? That's quite a tricky thing to look at. That's something to have a nice dialogue on. And again, this is an area that the tool might improve on. And when we first were specifying the tool 2 years ago, we talked exactly about this, about how to manage deltas and maintain the images on Commons. It's a tricky thing. This is an example of a notice from last week. I finished this very large upload, stuck a notice out, giving an example of some of the images from, in this case, 290,000 images have been uploaded. I can't show you 290,000 images. I can show you a nice sample of the sorts of things they are. In this case, it includes drawings and photographs, and I explain that. And as a result of that, I got quite a lot of feedback from the community, and there are hundreds of edits a day going on these images, just as we're putting this notice on Commons. People got rather excited about it, and they're re-cataloging, fixing problems that I was unaware of, raising other issues with me that need fixing, you know, more systematically, which I'm looking at. And in terms of the improvement plan, there's a couple of questions here pitched on. We're aware of the training material. There's a manual, yes, it's long. There's a video on the manual, which does help. We could do with simpler training materials, just for people who don't want to know all the wrinkles, ins and outs, just want to go on something or want to test it. I said it only uploads with the question about what happens with stuff that isn't published on the internet. We don't have a good process for that at the moment. We would like the tool to be able to upload local files, just to, a workaround might be posting it somewhere else, as an FTP folder somewhere, maybe. We're still talking about that. And at the moment, the error reporting needs improvement. We've got the user group list, and as more and more people start using it, we'll think more about how to give them feedback on what's happening with their uploads. It can be done, and I've talked to the developers about how we're going to fix that. That's actually quite a fixable thing to make it slightly better. And we can build up what sort of feedback users want on their uploads. We may even give the progress of the upload for large uploads. We don't even know. We just need to know whether it's happened. So
maybe does the tool does something on the opposite side, because many brands, after donating and the community working, fixing, adding information, wants to, you know, drink the material back to them with a corrected, let's say, metadata. So is it possible to...
We have talked about it. It's actually a very complicated thing to do. At the moment, the only examples I have are piecemeal examples where we've gone back and said, this looks, the copyright on this, I'm not sure this is right, or the title of this is wrong. There have been examples in some of the collections I've uploaded where they've just been wrongly identified. So, for example, where that's somewhere like the Library of Congress, there is a process for reporting back to the Library of Congress. But we don't have a partner inside the Library of Congress that's actively pursuing those changes to correct their master catalogue, which is the public catalogue, which we'd like to do as part of the value of doing it. I'll take this question. But,
Let me. Okay. Are you aware that the Media Foundation is currently working on turning what we currently have in templates on those image description pages into actual structured metadata?
Yes. I'm very much aware of that. It'd be very interesting. We're a very long way away from implementing something. And obviously I'd be very happy to work on that.
It would be very interesting to talk to you about
change. So I'm very happy to see the dialogue.
I'm working on that. Yes. So I want to talk to you.
If he doesn't want to talk to you, I'll talk to you.
I want to write it for you. Yes. I've said that, I think I pretty briefly mentioned, at the moment we only take in XML files as the input, telling us what files are and a good description about them. And it'd be great to have more types. It's not going to stop us adding more types. In the original specification, when we pulled that together as a steering group, there are over 20 different input file types that we wanted. And just one of the things in the agile development process, we've limited it down to a doable XML file. This is an improvement we do intend to do. It's not that hard to do. And depending on demand, we might have to prioritize it. And there is an email list, which is effectively the user group. I would like to see the user group become slightly more formal, so that when we talk about the next round of funding to get these things changed, there is a quite a better structured way, not just putting things in what we call Bugzilla, where things are raised for ops and dev. Inside the wiki media foundation to pay attention. But actually the user group has a proper dialogue about the end user requirements rather than just bugs they want fixed, which is slightly different perspective. And it does tie in with other discussions we've had over this weekend about the OpenGLAM initiatives and whether that some of this might sit under their longer term objectives. So this tool might be part of a pack of other tools, and we can talk about funding and maintenance of it, its promotion. And the other thing that was part of the original reason for setting up the steering group wasn't just the upload tool, but actually to improve GLAM reporting, which is still, we do have GLAM reports, you've probably heard of Glamorous, you know, playing around with it, but there are issues with reliable reporting, particularly if you want to report about what has already happened. So actually, we uploaded this 6 months ago, we'd like to sort out better reporting now. Actually, we don't have good solutions for that. We have some solutions for if you want to set up reports so you can rely on them for the coming months, for not going backwards. There's not any particular reason that there's no reason it can't be done, it's just that the current systems don't particularly help you to do it. And these are the sorts of questions that, again, might take a bit of investment and well specified. We've done it to some extent. There's been a number of documents produced on this in the past. We'd like to read these and talk about that. Okay, I'd just like to highlight the reality of what the outcomes are. This is one of the very large collections I've uploaded. I didn't write that file name, that was generated for me. You can't name 290,000 files by hand, it's too hard. But the file name is of a structure that most commons people would be very happy with. It's descriptive, and it can be found by the reference number. In this case, HABS TX3522A7 is meaningful for this particular survey. It means actually if you Google that on the internet, you'll probably find this image, and you'll probably find the Library of Congress record for it. You may actually find some discussion about it somewhere. And it's got some basic starter categories. Hopefully volunteers over the coming months and years will continue working on improving that. Historic places, which are quite nicely within the WikiHouse Monuments project, as well as in this case, the history of America. So people are quite interested in these things if they can find them. And in this case, there is actually a category that someone created called the National Register of Historic Places in Bastrop in Texas. Who's from Texas? Is Bastrop right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Have you heard of this place? So there are things that we don't know from that description. The categories don't tell us much more than that, like the age of the building and so forth, or the architect. And those are the sorts of things that might be useful additional categories. But the source information wasn't structured in a way that I could reuse it very well to do a lot more category matching than that. Okay, and that's the same page with this example of the building. If you look at this page, it's quite nicely structured. There's quite a lot of data on it. it's actually got a link. We've got there's a sort of a long grey box that actually gives you a link to the National Register of Historic Places number, and it gives you a rather clever Wikidata-enabled type link that pushes you to a tool that shows you related photographs, which is quite useful if you're going to pull together a category and write a report on this building, or you're writing a Wikipedia article about it. It's got very clear licensing. It's very clearly public domain. That assessment has been done. And all the other useful data that can be pulled out of the original record is in there, such as the size of the photograph, the year of which the documentation was put together for the photograph. And it obviously links you back to the original source in a very easy to find way. So you're not just trapped on commons. It's got very nice attribution back to where it came from, and you can go and see the original record. But that raises a question: why would you upload this to commons? Is this actually better than just promoting the source? It's a good question. In this particular case, I would recommend people go to commons, because I do fantastic work. And this is the source that I got it from. And you'll notice that the source, which is a very nice official source, the Library of Congress — thank you very much, Library of Congress, for the work you do — the particular image has much more limited information. And it says slightly worrying things, such as in red at the bottom, "Rights assessments is your responsibility." We've done that assessment for you on Commons, much clearer. The other information was interestingly put together because we used the National Register of Historic Places number and Wikidata to find more information in a rather complicated way, but we did sort it out. It's a very large collection, this is what we're doing. So if I go back, actually there were a lot of notes there about this site, and it told you a lot more, but the Library of Congress only tells you that. That's the sort of extra value that using Wikimedia projects can add to an archive collection, even very significant collections like the Library of Congress. But I wouldn't for 1 minute say that we're better than the Library of Congress. My next big project is with the Welcome Images, which I'm doing, and they have a beautiful collection, but not just about medicine. So this is a quick plug. I'm working with Wiki Project to listen to make that happen as well. Let's go to questions. Few people are keen. Do you remember what your questions were?
How does the funding future look like? Develop this tool further?
Can you repeat that again?
What sources is it funded from, the next phase of the project?
That's a good question. The original funding, when we put together the steering group 2 years ago, at that time, if I remember correctly, I was the Chapters Association chair. And so I had quite a lot of weight with chapters. And I pushed them into chipping in funding. So most of my funding started with chapters. We had no funding from the foundation. And that was enough to do this development. This next stage, there's a Europeana helping with a proposal that may have European funding that may be significant. But there's nothing to stop us putting a grant proposal into the foundation. Europeana can do that. That's less reliant on an odd collection of chapters, when some of them actually have difficulty funding such a program for legal reasons. And they're also less reliable as a long-term funding partner. Someone like a local chapter, their issues change from year to year, and actually it's quite nice to go to a very large funding body to fund something like this. Another question?
Alex Beam. For phones that do have a lot of custom information, fields. I'm pretty sure you could create the custom templates in the commons, right?
That's right. And if I go back to this example, you can see there's a credit line. That's not a nice, in the middle there's a photograph of some gentleman standing in front of a building. And that's a template that was put together for the Historic American Landscape Survey, which is now owned by the National Parks.
So you can create that template?
I certainly can, and anybody can.
Okay.
And there's nothing to stop an institution. Commons is a bit more flexible. People have heard of Wikipedia's worries about promoting companies, but actually, if it's your archive, you can have a very nice credit line. It can point to your whatever landing page on your website you want, and you can have some nice images on there and make it look pretty. In fact, I really would like it to make it pretty so people engage with that information structure. as well as some of the bulk standing licenses. You can also create a version of a license if you want to, which is slightly more controversial. But remember, we are talking about moving into a future where we might have structured data, and we're trying to rather more limit the wide variety of licenses as an option. So I quite like credit templates, because there's nothing to stop those continuing to be whatever you want. Mm.
What are the possibilities when you've used an XML to batch upload to iterate on that? So for instance, if the institution improves the metadata on their side, so not on Commons, but through their own work, can they update the records as they live on Commons?
Strange enough, at the moment, yes. It does work. I would suggest discussing that rather carefully before doing it for a large collection. If I run an XML file twice, it will regenerate any changes in the XML file I have. So if you've changed the XML file with new data, it will create a new text page for the image. If the image is unchanged, it won't upload the new file. So that actually does exactly what you want. The slight wrinkle in that is that if volunteers have done valuable work, adding new categories, fixing the descriptions, maybe fixing fundamental data like the date or the author, you actually want to preserve that.
No.
And that's why I say it takes a little bit of discussion, because I'm someone like myself would know how to check for that and make sure that the ones that have been edited and had significant changes don't just get overwritten, and then you can think about what's been going on. So that's the sort of check you want to do first. But yes, this is a longer discussion, I think, about deltas and how we maintain against, say, an external catalogue in a way that doesn't overwrite the value that the volunteers are adding. And as I think it was Shani's point, doing it the other way, to say, actually, somebody's found, in the Library of Congress, this photograph is incorrectly indexed. Is there a process for automatically going back and reporting on those changes? It can be done, it just takes a little bit of work and a bit of thought. What scenarios then apply. What's helpful is to do some of these very large uploads and then see what happens and see how important some of these theoretical concerns are and how practical some of the solutions are. That's why we want several million images uploaded, and then we can have a proper discussion about, as a user group, about where we want this to go and what we should prioritize.
Second comment.
Okay, one more question then.
Yeah, what's the capacity or performance of the media commons? Upload tons of thousands of images, do we have the capacity to store it, to have bandwidth, to serve that?
The answer is that the foundation had a commitment to do that. I did, in my earlier uploads, I did break Commons 1 week, literally break it. And the reason was I was uploading extraordinarily large TIFF files of maps, huge maps, that couldn't be rendered properly in the MediaWiki software. And I had to create, it was the way the format. And operations, I'm on camera, so operations were concerned, but they were very nice to me, and they sorted out the problem within about a week. And the reason they were very committed to sorting this out is that the foundation is committed for something like a project like Commons to be unlimited. You should be able to upload a million images. You should be able to upload, at the current time, 1 gigabyte files. If you talk to them, you can upload files much larger than 1 gigabyte. You just need to be slightly cautious that you're not uploading of somewhat useful stuff, which you might be.
So the intention is that I upload the raw format, like the best quality possible.
Yes. Absolutely. And in my uploads from, in this case, the New York Public Library, I uploaded the original, highest possible resolution available public maps. And these were extraordinarily large files, 20,000 pixels across, that sort of size. And the file size is up to, some of them over 300 megabytes, which is a very large file. One of the beauties of Commons is that you don't have to look at that enormously large file in a monitor, which you can't really display. You can choose lower resolution versions of it without it draining your computer or your end. Okay, thank you very much.
And if people are interested, we have a really nice flyer about language tools that you can take home and and get in touch. It's right here.
Thanks for
the Gracias.